Let's all stand to open up worship service.
Good morning and welcome to each and every one of you. We want to be sure that you're aware, and please keep in your prayers our youth group who are in Cushing, Oklahoma today and for the rest of this week, teaming up with them and bringing together a vacation Bible school. And a great group headed out on Friday, and they arrived safely, and all is well with them. And so keep them in your prayers and for the good things that are going to go on and the lives that will be transformed and the way that they're going to draw closer together. Thankful for your presence here today. Want to extend a special welcome to those of you who are guests today. We thank you for taking the time to be here. Hope that you have already been greeted in the name of the Lord. Hope that you've already been blessed by your investment of time. And it is our prayer that we might continue that blessing beyond this particular hour. And to accomplish that, we'd ask that you'd take one of the guest cards the blue guest cards that you'll find in the rack on the back of the pew just in front of you there. Fill that out as much of the information on both sides of that card as you're comfortable with, as we would again like to know a little more about you, have ways to contact you, and again to extend the blessing of this hour beyond this day, this moment, certainly would. I hope that you got a copy of your Caring and Sharing, a number of things there that you'll want to be sure and take a look at, a number of announcements that are there, a number of prayer requests that are there that you'll want to be sure and pay attention to. Thank you for being good readers of the Caring and Sharing. It answers a lot of questions. It certainly does. Want to be sure and emphasize that tonight we'll be back here at 6 o'clock where we will be hearing Dave Clayton. Dave Clayton will be presenting a lesson from Revelation chapter 5 called The Slaughtered Lamb. And I've heard the presentation and I know that you'll be blessed by that. I bring you greetings from the brothers and sisters in the at the Sweeney Church of Christ, as I was there on Wednesday night to be part of their summer series, and they sent their greetings to you as well. The text today is going to call us to be people who hear and see. This is not a new call. It's not a new concept to this particular part of the text in Matthew chapter 13. It is kind of the way the whole Bible has unfolded. We see God creating, and then he creates man, and he kind of asks him to hear my word and see what I've done. Know that I am here. Be aware of me and respond to me in worship and in honor. Worship to me, respond to me as I am holy by what you hear and see. Again, we come to the Mount Sinai, and again, God becomes visible and audible. We hear him and we see him, and he says, respond to me. We come to the prophets who, over and over again, every prophet will in some way or another say, you're a people who have eyes, but you don't see. You have ears, but you don't hear. We're invited to be a people who hear and see. We've been through a week, and we talked about in Bible class that this week is not unique in the last century of Christians being in the United States of America. Of things that are contrary to what we understand the Creator to want, things that are contrary to what the Creator has asked for, things that are contrary to the way He brought creation together to bring about a blessing, our country is deciding to side against God's Word. What do we hear and what do we see? First of all, what we hear should not surprise us in any way. It is not a country that has in any form or fashion for an extended period of time now, if it ever was a country that tried to be God's place, it hasn't been for a long time. And so it shouldn't surprise us that the Supreme Court would rule without respect to what God would reveal about his creation and about his blessing. What do we see? So often what we see is people getting up in arms and angry. And by the way, there should be an anger, but I'm not sure that it should be at the lawmakers. There should be an anger because what's going on, again, if it's contrary to what God wants, it is consistent with the chaos and the destruction that Satan would want to bring. Paul said it well. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. Our battle is against the spiritual authorities and those kinds of things like that. And I would ask you to become a people of prayer. Excuse me. To continue to be a people of prayer. To add to your prayers. Prayers for people. And by the way, not for our own children. Let's be sure and say that if our children, if you're raising children and you're not bringing them to church, then there's more reason this week than there was last Sunday to bring your children to church. If you're not bringing your children to Bible class, there's more reason this Sunday than there was last Sunday for them to be in Bible class. If you're not reading your Bible to your children, grandchildren, I don't know. Anybody got greats out there that they read to? Yes, okay. And she'll admit it, and I'm proud of you for that. I'm looking for the day when I get to admit maybe just that I have a grandchild, let alone great. But nonetheless, if you didn't have a reason to read them the Bible last Sunday, you have a reason today, more of a reason today. Your children should not be the ones who are threatened by a ruling like this because they are children of the people of God. Amen. Unfortunately, we live in a country where the people of God, the people that live according to God's law, are becoming fewer and fewer. And so, our prayers should be for children who will grow up not knowing the message of God's blessing, not knowing a lifestyle that is consistent with what God wants to provide for them and what God wants to protect them from. And don't expect this to be the last. It may be in this generation, I don't know. It may be in this generation when we get to find out what it is to be a persecuted church. If, by the way, if we aren't already, and maybe we are, although let's be sure and say that you sitting there and us being in air-conditioned comfort and having the lights on and do it in the middle of the day sort of means that we're not being persecuted, understand? So in this generation, we may become a persecuted church and we may get to be the people who read multiple times from Jesus' mouth, from Paul's mouth, from Peter's mouth, count it all joy Rejoice. Understand that when you are harmed for the sake of Christ, you can know for certain that you are His people. Amen. Not something I'm looking forward to, not something I'm happy about. But let us be a people who pray. Amen. Let us be a people who pray for the children who will grow up, not knowing that they were created by a God who has a plan for His blessing, and that there is a life that follows out of that plan and that blessing. And let us live in such a way that is humbly submitted to what God wants in our life, but is still lived out in mercy towards them and in being the peacemakers that Jesus would have us to be. Yeah, it's going to be a hard place to stand. May we be up to the task. I invite you to come together and worship. Today's scripture is going to include this statement. For thousands of years, people waited to see and hear what you see and hear. Folks, for millennia, people have longed to know God's Messiah, and you know Him. And you experience Him. And He is a part of your life. And by the way, Jesus is not less Messiah because the Supreme Court doesn't recognize God's created order. God is not taken off His throne by what happened. And we should be ready to rejoice in who God is. Why don't you come together and worship?
Let the ancient words in It's been kind of a interesting 3 weeks. School got out. Some people, you know, were getting ready to transition between the high school, and some kids are thinking, you know, what is it that we're planning on heading off to go do? I spent a couple of days up in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, helping my daughter move. She's a little closer for you guys from Oklahoma. She's now in Oklahoma, so she's a little closer, which makes it a little nicer. It's only a 9-hour trip versus 2 days to get to Milwaukee. So this has been kind of nice, and I now get to do the things that teachers normally do during the summer, which is start doing all my training. So here in a little bit, I get to go to drive up to Fort Worth and start learning about AP Physics and some more things with that, because I'll be starting to teach that as well as teaching AP Computer Sciences next year. So it's going to be an interesting year. Yet at the same time, I'm very happy, joyful, because I have to remember that God's giving us challenges, God's giving us blessings. Sometimes they're not the same thing, but they're also things that we have to kind of consider. So will you pray with me, please? Dear God, we are thankful for the challenges that you give to us. We understand or don't understand, we ask for that understanding, that what is the blessing that comes from this? How am I to grow? How am I going to develop into a better Christian? How can I support? How can I be with the church? How can I help? All these things are driving us to tell and figure out what it is that we do in our everyday life. How can I be the Christian you want me to be? And it's a tough road. We understand that, but we ask that blessing, that help, that support to continue to be the Christian that you want us to do. Things this week are going to challenge us. We have to stand on our principles, have to stand on your principles, and we have to understand where it is and how to be challenged so that we can accept that challenge and to be the Christian you want us to be. We ask for that strength and to show that Christ is still alive in this world as we live. And we ask for all of that through your Son's name. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. The question was posed to me, what did Jesus expect us? What did Jesus expect of us when we partake of the Lord's Supper? And in looking at the four Gospels, Matthew and Mark, now he says, do this in remembrance of me. They take the Lord's Supper, they sing a hymn, and they head out in those accounts. In the Gospel of Mark, or I'm sorry, in the Gospel of Luke, they stick around just a little bit longer and they talk about who is the greatest in heaven, and then they head out. And if you look at the Gospel of John, they spend what is broken up in this gospel as a couple of chapters talking about different things after the Lord's Supper before you see them somewhere else. And so I spent some time in John looking at what Jesus was saying to them at this time, immediately after they shared the bread and the wine, some of his final thoughts to them before his arrest and his crucifixion. And so I'm going to be reading several verses from the 14th chapter, just some things that Jesus said to them in this setting. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may also be. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another, a helper that will be with you forever. I will not leave you as orphans. I come to you. After a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me, because I live, you will live also. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, he is the one who loves me. He who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will disclose myself to him. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and he will come to him and make an abode with him. So many things have happened. It's an interesting week in our country. But go back to John 14, verse 1. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. Amen. Bow with me, please. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you to partake of this meal, this remembrance. Remembering, Lord, the things that are written for us, that you spoke to your disciples, that they spread the word, that they spread to the world. We ask that our hearts not be troubled, that we remember the grave is empty. No matter what else happens, the battle has already been fought. The war has already been won. We ask that we take this bread in a manner pleasing in your sight, Lord, remembering these things, remembering the sacrifices made for us, so that our hearts will not be troubled. Through your Son's name we pray. Amen. Bow with me again, please. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessings on this cup, the blood of your Son, the blood of the new covenant, the blood that washes us free from sin. Lord, be with us as we partake of this. Be with us as we strive to live for you. Through your Son's name we pray. Amen. Now we come to a time to give back, as we're instructed, a portion of that which we've been blessed with. Guests, if you filled out those guest cards, this would be a good time to put them in the plate as it comes by as well. Bow with me in blessing this offering. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you would bless our gift to you, knowing that we are just stewards of all that you provide for us, Lord. We ask that we would use this gift wisely for the things that we need, for the things that our missionaries need that we support around the world. We ask that you continuously bless us. Through your Son's name we pray. Amen. And as that collection is being taken up, now we can let the kids come forward and do their kids' gift on their way to Praise Kids and Stage 2. Go ahead and bring your gifts up and head on out if you so choose.
I see. Reading from the scripture, Matthew 13, verses 1 through 9. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. He was scattering the seed. Some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But then the sun came out, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. The other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. He who has ears, let him hear.
I just want to be sure and tell everyone that's sitting on this side of the auditorium, it's not your turn to leave next week, okay? We need all of us to fill up both sides of the auditorium before we're done this summer. Again, glad that you're here. We city folks call it dirt. We call things dirty because they have this on it. We go down our sidewalks and we sweep the dirt off, and mamas come out of the kitchen and they sweep the dirt out, but it's not dirt, is it, Jerry? We have lost our moorings when we say dirt, because what it really is soil. And soil is one of the most beautiful of and amazing and so understated creations that God has placed on this earth. Life comes from the soil. I think it is significant that in Scripture, the way chapter 2 talks about it is God took, and we could say, we sometimes say the dust of the ground, but in reality, he took the soil, something that he made, and he made us from it. And when you think about all the life that comes from that thin little layer of soil, it's just amazing, because all of life depends on it in some way or another. You and I depend on it. The ecosystem depends on it. The whole thing depends on this thing called soil, which is, I would say to you, not a product of evolution, but is a product of creation. Soil, that good soil. You and I are pretty removed from that culture. By the way, that's the way you know that you've left the agrarian society, is when you look at it and you say, boy, look at that dirt. What am I going to do with that dirt? But we're pretty removed from it in a lot of other ways. But the people of Jesus' day, particularly the people who gathered around him as he stepped out into the boat there in Galilee, knew on a very intimate and kind of personal way what agriculture was about. Even the people that probably fished for a living, even the people that made pottery for a living, the people that were masons for a living, when it came time to put the harvest in, everybody got involved. And probably the way it was set up is that every family actually had a stake in the harvest. They had a little portion of the greater, larger community's field that would surround each of these little towns. There's a beautiful scene that comes together, but it is at the same time, I can also tell that you're not a first century farmer, because you didn't laugh as Danny read the passage. Because as soon as we hear about a farmer going out to sow his seed, We know exactly what's going on, but then he suddenly begins to throw seed absolutely everywhere. What is he doing? Where is it going? Where the stones are in the field are not an undetermined place. The stones are gathered up and put into an area so that you don't put the seeds there. The weeds are kind of a little different thing, probably underneath trees that would have been around the fields. You weren't going to be able to cultivate and get much of a harvest from underneath the shade of the trees. Maybe along the water sources, a few places like that where the field transitioned from productive ground, the weeds would be there. And again, you knew that that is not where to put the seed if you were a relatively sensible farmer. And you particularly didn't throw it on the path. You need to understand that this is not a road that's sitting, you know, again, we drive by fields between here and Dallas all the time, but it's, you know, it's 200 feet in that direction. All their fields were broken up into very small, manageable little plots that you could farm by hand, not with large implements, and all of them would be divided by these well-packed, well-defined, hard paths. And nobody ever put seed on the path, except this ridiculous farmer who goes out to sow his seed. They all laughed, and he told them exactly what they knew, is that if it landed on the path, it was just going to get picked up and carried away. That's why you don't put the seed there. If it landed in the rocks, it was going to maybe germinate, but it wasn't really going to be able to produce. And if it landed in the weeds, it was going to be really hard to harvest, particularly, but it also would get choked out there as well. A beautiful story. I think possibly this becomes the story that Jesus maybe began all of his parable teachings with. It is kind of that ultimate statement of here's what the parables are about, here's what God is looking for in your life, in the same way that the Beatitudes were maybe the introduction to the kind of teaching maybe he did in a synagogue or something akin to that. The parables given to us, these stories. Matthew chapter 13 is going to unfold with all of these stories. And this is the lead one. It's the one that introduces the story. It's the one that defines a lot of different things that we're going to hear in the echoes in the rest of the stories. The rest of them will say, the kingdom of heaven is like. And I don't think for a minute that we should think that just because he didn't begin the story of the sower, the story of the seed, the story of the soils, whatever you want to call it, just because it doesn't begin with the statement the kingdom of heaven is like, doesn't mean that we don't understand that this parable has a lot to say about the kingdom of heaven. And the reason we know that is that he repeats the parable, but not in the mysterious form, but in the explanatory form. Just a minute later. Read with me, further down in chapter 13. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The one who received the seed that fell on rocky places is the man who hears the word and at once receiving it at hears the word and once receives it with joy. But since he has no root, he lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, he quickly falls away. The one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it, making it unfruitful. But the one who received the seed that fell on good soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. He produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Won't you join me in prayer? Father God, we thank you for your word. But Father, we thank you not only for what is written in this book, but we thank you for the way the word of your kingdom infiltrates our life, pierces our hearts, becomes a part of who we are, and isn't just a spoken word, but it is a word that produces action. It is a word that has acted on our life and a word that produces that same kind of response of graciousness and mercy in our own lives. Father, we ask that you would help us to be people who see, to see it the way you see it. And Father, may we be people who hear. And in hearing, may we be those who, as the explanation says, who understand. And in doing so, being the kind of soil, having the kind of hearts, may we produce what you have sown into us in the world around us. Not just in the neat, tidy places that we want to put it, but everywhere, just as you have done. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, and the whole church said. Hearing. Seed is like hearing. Hearing a message about the kingdom is what the New International Version says. Hearing the news of the kingdom is another of the translations. Hearing the good news, and again, put it in capital letters, the gospel, the good news of the kingdom. But ultimately, what it really says and what we should probably translate and understand is the idea that the seed is the word of the kingdom. That same word that kind of means many, many different things. For instance, it's exactly the same word that we have in the first chapter of John when the word was in the beginning. It's God's movement. It is God's message, but it also has less to do with what's written necessarily on the page than what God spoke at the creation. And what God continues to speak as he continues to create in us his kingdom in so many different ways. These seeds are this word of the kingdom that Jesus has already been teaching. And again, we can turn back to chapter 5, and we have 5, 6, and 7 where Matthew puts together this great Sermon on the Mount, and we have this word of God. And particularly in the center of that are these statements by Jesus that you have read your text and understand the law this way, but God's word really speaks into the matters of the heart. And then chapters 5, 6, and 7, where Jesus speaks this word of the kingdom, he then lives into the word of the kingdom as several miracles of healing come about. And he will continue to do just exactly that. He will speak this word of the kingdom, and then he will do this word of the kingdom. This is the effect of the kingdom. This is the ripples of the kingdom. This seed is the impact of the kingdom, whether it is a spoken word or whether it is a word that comes through action and activity, by the way, activity that is consistent with the kingdom of God. It is something that proclaims that no matter what you see out there, out in the world around us, God has a good that he wants to do. No matter how many lies are told out there in the world, God has a truth that he wants you to know. And that truth has an impact, and it changes people. And that life has a life-changing kind of effect going on around it. Note, and I just want to say that this was kind of one of those things that kind of jumped off the page at me this time in reading it through. Note that all four soils, including the soil that is the path, the hard path, all four soils actually hear. They hear the word of the kingdom. Now let's be sure and say that the soil of the path hears something but doesn't believe it, instantaneously rejects it. It is a hardness of heart that simply says, I will not believe that the resurrection occurred. I will not believe that God sent his son. I will not believe that there was a creation, that God brought all of this together and continues to save it, sustain it. I will not believe that. And so that word which is heard is not accepted and can't really penetrate the surface. So even there we have hearing. All of them hear. And you need to understand that the hearing word is a significant word for Jesus. He doesn't change the word when he moves from the process of just kind of the sound waves hitting our ear to the idea that I am hearing something that is making an impact on me. I am hearing and listening, and I want to know more, and I want to make it a part of my life. That's the same word that's used, and it takes the context for us to understand. So clearly, the seed that falls on the path has heard something, but it hasn't really penetrated the life. The others, they hear. And you need to understand that when it penetrates that soil and the seed germinates, I think there's really a response to the kingdom of God there. We might even say that there's a conversion, if we want to say it that way. Something is going on. It has done what the seed is supposed to do. It has produced, in some way, a plant. So you see this belief thing, this initial, yes, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Yes, I believe that God is the creator of the universe. Yes, I believe that he rose from the dead. Yes, I believe is not everything that God calls us to be about. The word of the kingdom has to penetrate a little further. The heart of the receiver has to invite a little different something than just the acknowledgement of intellectual ideas. Has to do more than just assent to God's sort of order of things. Whenever we look at Scripture, we always need to pay attention to the arrangement. And yes, I understand that we can say, well, it's arranged this way because that's exactly the way Jesus did it. But at the same time, even if Jesus did it that way, the writers use arrangement to emphasize. And so it's interesting that the telling of the parable and the explaining of the parable have something in between. In fact, it's actually the largest section. If we were divided into three parts, it holds the majority of the space there. So let's see what Jesus, before we determine what this good soil that we want to be and what this word of the kingdom is supposed to do, let's hear what Jesus has to say to the disciples. The disciples came to him and asked, "Why do you speak to the people in parables?" And he replied, "The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you." By the way, I don't think that is, when Matthew writes it, it's not just the sense of it's given to the 12 disciples. He's speaking to a church now. And by the way, some nearly 2,000 years later, you are the people who the secrets, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven have been revealed to. But it's not to them. We shouldn't be surprised that they don't get it, because they haven't bought into that seed yet. "Whoever has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has, will be taken away from him." This is not just an action. This is not just economics at work. And we kind of can relate to that. If I have a big bucket load of capital over here, I can put that to work and I can make a lot more capital. If I'm one of those people that has a much, much smaller little cup of capital over here, I just have to use that cup just to survive, and so I don't have the ability to do that. More than that is going on with Jesus' statement. Those of you who have, continue to invest, and you build on that. And that can be built into generations. That can be built into the way that it becomes more intensely involved in your life. It gets built in the way that those of you who have gathered together in assembly and in church and in the unity of fellowship, and it becomes more prominent. It shines brighter, to go back to the Sermon on the Mount and use that image. Those who don't have, don't get to just kind of maintain sort of an association with the kingdom of God. The more that they choose to reject, the more that they harden, it becomes further and further and further away from them. It isn't that the sower is not out there sowing the seed absolutely everywhere. It's that rejection builds greater rejection, which builds greater rejection. This is what we see in Pharaoh's story. Pharaoh, who initially hardens his heart and won't release the children of Israel, turns around and that process of not listening to God, of not seeing what God's doing, then produces a state where God is hardening his heart. It's not a determinism thing. It's the fruits of your action produce a result. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they don't see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing but never perceiving. Be sure you understand, and let's finish the prophecy. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. This is a prophecy not written to the world. This is a prophecy that's written to God's people. And we need to take it seriously. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand. See, hear, understand with their hearts. And that produces something. Turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, because they see, and your ears, because they hear. I tell you the truth, many prophets and righteous men long to see what you see, Jesus, the kingdom breaking in through the life of Jesus, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, the proclamation of kingdom in all its forms, what you hear, but did not hear it. There's a powerful thing going on in this parable, and it speaks to us. This idea that they hear and that they might hear and that they might see, and then that next step that they might understand with their hearts and turn. You see, that kind of understanding is not about intellect, nor is it about having some sort of spiritual or super spiritual insight into things. That understanding is a word that kind of gets unfolded both in the New Testament and Old Testament, and it gets associated with the idea of wisdom. And again, we in our time and our place and our understanding, particularly our Greek minds, want to say, well, that's about being smarter, isn't it? No. Wisdom is always, and this idea of understanding is always about taking what God says and having it change our lives. To hear and understand is not just to give assent to, oh yes, God said it and it's true and therefore I believe it. You've heard that phrase before maybe. But it's to say that yes, God said it. Yes, I believe it. And my life will be different because of that. That is the kind of understanding that becomes good soil. That is the kind of way in which Jesus expects us to be about the process of producing a fruit, a harvest of the word of the kingdom. Change sourced in the heart, a real change, something that I notice and something that those around me begin to notice. Because it isn't just about little things on the outside, but it's wholly and completely making my life move in a new and different sort of way. And so we join with Jesus in the prayer. Your kingdom come. And so often our temptation is to very quickly say, yes, we want your kingdom to come out there, and we want your kingdom to come over there, and we want your kingdom to come in the Supreme Court of the United States. And not that that isn't a reality, that we would want that. But the first place that the kingdom has to come is in my life. Amen. The first change that God wants to see happen is not, what is the world going to do differently? But what am I going to do differently? How am I going to see differently? How am I going to hear? How am I going to act differently? What is the harvest that's looked for? I've heard this preached a lot of different ways. Primarily, how many people are you going to get baptized in your lifetime? How many people are you going to bring to the Lord? And that, therefore, God planted a seed in you, and then you produce multiple seeds. That isn't what the seed is. Notice that the seed falls on the path. It's not a conversion. It is not a life that is consumed by the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. What are we going to produce a crop in? We're going to produce a crop in that we hear it, and we see it, we understand it, we turn and change in such a way that the reality of God's good news, the reality of God's domain and reign and effect on the world, the reality of God's lordship is going to be proclaimed when we say it and what we say and the way we live and the way we live. And the people around us are not going to be able to deny that there's something different about that, not just person, but that group of folks. Amen. They care about the hurting. They see sin, and then as opposed to condemning the sinner, they want to love people that are hurt by sin. Amen. They're different. They don't see possessions as something to be held on to. They see possessions as something to be used to bless others. They don't see their time as their own. They don't see their talents as just things to make them look good. They want to change the world. They want to change the world one little life, one little moment at a time. Won't you come? Won't you come with that heart that says, God, I want to hear. God, I want to see. But most of all, won't you come and say, God, I want you to change me. Won't you come as we stand and sing?
To the voice of Jesus, fallen tenderly upon your ears. Speak his cry of love and pity, calleth, turn and listen, stay and hear. Ye that labor and are heavy laden, lean upon your dear Lord's breast. Ye that labor and are heavy laden, come and I will give you rest. Take his yoke, for he is meek and lowly. Bear his burden to him, turn. He who calleth is a master holy. He will teach if you will learn. Ye that labor and are heavy laden, lean upon your dear Lord's breast. Ye that labor and are heavy laden, come and I will give you rest.
Be seated.
Again, we thank you for your presence here today and hope you have been blessed by the service. If you are a guest, I know we do have some guests in the audience. If you will raise your hand, you'll be offered some bread. So please don't hesitate to raise your hand, and just thank you for your presence today. Nancy Coburn gave me a note that she was asking for prayers last time for her grandson, Bryson, that they would receive custody of him. But that court case did not, our court date did not take place due to the conflict with one of the lawyers. And it's going to take place on July the 28th. So let's keep that family in our prayers and continue to pray for a favorable outcome that Bryson will be reunited in a favorable relationship with his mother. Don't forget this evening at 6 o'clock, the Summer Family Faith Feast. it'll be on Revelations chapter 5. And also, there'll be a salad dinner afterwards, a Mexican type salad type dinner. So if you bring your favorite dish, I know that everyone will enjoy that. So remember that if you will. And let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Father, we just thank you for Jesus. We thank you for him coming to the world and providing salvation to the world. We pray that you will be with the congregation here as we worship you. We pray that we will have a faith and understanding of what you would have us to do, and that things that we do here will glorify and benefit your kingdom. We pray that you will be with the Coburn family as they strive to get custody of Bryson. Pray that that outcome will be successful. We ask that you'll be with our youth as they're on a mission trip, that they're will be traveling home, and just pray that you're for their safety while they're there. And we pray that their experience will bless them, and that it also will bless the people in that area, the children especially, putting on a vacation Bible school. We pray that that will be a blessing to the congregation there and a blessing to the children in that area. Father, just help us to pray for our country. We pray for our leaders. So we pray that they can include you in the decisions that they make. Seems like they want to get away from you and to do what they want to do. And just help them to turn back to including you in the decisions that they make throughout the time that they're in office. Help us also remember, Father, that this world is just a passing through stage in our life. Mm-hmm. That sometimes we forget that, and sometimes we say that, well, I'm going to be here for forever, and we live in such a way that that's the case, and we don't realize sometimes that this is temporary, and things will pass and change. We ask for forgiveness of things that we do that are in error or fall short of your will. We ask that you forgive us of those things. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please rise.
Who paints the skies into glorious day?